Hey everybody, welcome to the fourth and final episode in our series devoted to digital identity on Blockchain Central. Today, we'll focus on how digital identity applies to the living and breathing human beings. It's going to be interesting. Every month, we publish three videos, two in-depth explorations into the fascinating world of blockchains, and one video where we summarize the most important events of the previous month. If you want to stay up to date with our content, be sure to click the subscribe button and hit that little bell to always get notified when we drop a new video. Also, please be sure to check out our Medium blog at medium.com/@blockessence. See the link in the description box for details. You can also follow me on Instagram at @theBlueMantic to catch up with my other projects. Now, let's talk digital identity. If you follow our channel, as you should, you'll know that digital identity can be applied to an organization, an application, a device, or a person. We've already discussed how it can improve supply chains and help recognize and manage IoT machines, but digital identities can also apply to people. In this context, digital identity is a set of information relative to a specific person that allows them to prove their personal details. Digital identity can be used as a general validation for any identity claim and, as such, might find several applications. It can be especially useful in situations where providing confirmation of one's identity is needed, such as medical records, voting, taxation, or border crossing. Before we start to explain how blockchains are relevant to digital identity for human beings, let's focus on the concept of identity itself. The UN's Convention on the Rights of the Child grants every living person the most basic human right, the right to have an identity. It typically consists of one's name, date of birth, nationality, and state identifier, which can vary from country to country. Without having their identity confirmed, a person can't vote, work legally, or own property. Traditional government-level management of identity is centralized, which means that the process of issuing and validating is exclusively performed by state-authorized entities. For example, if you want to get access to various social media websites, you need to create a separate account for every single one of them. By doing that, you entrust your personal data to a third party, which can further relay it to other entities. This can significantly reduce the level of control you have over your personal information. What's even more concerning is your information might later be used in ways you haven't previously thought possible. That was the case with Cambridge Analytica, the well-publicized case of a serious privacy breach at Facebook. If you need a refresher, Cambridge Analytica's Dr. Alexander Kogan developed a mobile app which was harvesting Facebook users' personal data. Even though the claimed purpose was purely academic, it was later revealed that the gathered information was used to create psychographic maps, something very useful for targeted advertising. Facebook was accused of data breach, but claimed it was misled as to the purpose of data collection. In response, Cambridge Analytica said that commercial use was explicitly included in their terms of service. The case is still pending, and apart from being a clear example of personal data abuse, it raises another concern, the lack of transparency. It is really difficult for people to control what's happening with their personal details once they're given to a third party. This brings us to another fundamental issue associated with centralization, the potential for identity theft. Because your personal data, such as passport numbers, tax ID numbers, or credit card details, are stored in a centralized server, it makes them extremely prone to cyber attacks. And that's where blockchain steps up as a potential solution. Let's look at the following aspects of blockchains in handling personal ID: trustlessness, data integrity, security, simplicity, and privacy. A blockchain is typically described as trustless thanks to its distributed ledger mechanism. All the data, regardless of its purpose, is maintained and verified across numerous participating nodes. This eliminates two fundamental human-related causes of tampering: negligence and malevolent action. It is up to various consensus mechanisms to make sure that, before a valid decision is made, multiple nodes will sign off on it. Distributing the data through a peer-to-peer network makes it possible to keep the information consistent and up-to-date, something that is a core component of a larger phenomenon known as data integrity. This integrity is very important, as tampering with such public records can affect citizens, businesses, and public services. By indexing the stored data with hashes and putting it on the ledger, we can prevent this scenario from happening. Effectively, if any piece of data is changed, it ends up not matching the blockchain and is rejected. In addition to ensuring integrity and removing the need for trust inside the network, blockchains provide security and data encryptions. This can be achieved by using a so-called zero-knowledge proof, which is yet another method of authentication. Instead of verifying the validity of the information, it is the validity of the attester, for example, a state authority issuing documents, that is verified. By using zero-knowledge proof, we can effectively prove the information without disclosing it. Which brings us to the next subject, privacy. Zero-knowledge proof guarantees the trust between entities by allowing them to confirm any piece of data without revealing it. Of course, all data can be additionally secured by a cryptographic solution achieved by combining public and private keys with automated and decentralized management. Now, let's dive into the technical side of things. One way personal data can be handled on blockchain is by applying a unique identifier that can be freely created by any user. This is called a public decentralized identifier, or public DID. It is a token that identifies its subject, confirms one's control over it, and allows the owner to set trustable interactions. What's important, public DIDs don't depend on any centralized authority or identity providers. To make a claim verifiable, three actors are needed: a human user, an issuer, most likely an authority or an organization, and a claim, which is equal to any given statement or information. Please note that verifiable claims should not be confused with verifiable credentials, as the latter have a wider definition. A claim is a piece of information, while a credential is a definition of a specific group of claims. Verifiable credentials allow the owners to express real-life credentials on the blockchain in a secure and trustworthy manner. They include the framework that connects issuers, verifiers, and identity owners. Another important mechanism that enables digital identities to work in DLTs is decentralized key management system. By using the blockchain, it replaces the traditional distribution of key certificates given by a central institution with DIDs that are cryptographically generated so that a central registration is not required. Decentralization in blockchains effectively means the identity is managed by its holder, who fully controls the access to claims. It removes third parties from the process. This leads us to the phenomenon called a self-sovereign digital identity, whose main feature is that it fully belongs to its holder. It cannot be taken away or used without the user's consent. What is also important is that the amount of data used or disclosed can vary depending on the specific task that it's needed for. Now that we know the benefits and the technical aspects of digital identities on the blockchain, let's discuss the possibilities of its real-life usage. Widespread adoption might actually bring significant real-life benefits such as social analytics, reinforced border control, secure cashless payments, or more efficient taxation. It can also be used to ensure fair and democratic elections. As we all have recently witnessed, conventionally managed elections are vulnerable to at least several important issues. We can mention spreading of fake news, campaign disinformation, hacking databases with voters' personal information, or hacking the voting software, just to name a few. Hackers might also be tempted to tamper with the systems announcing the election's results. Let's see how blockchains can mitigate these issues. We already know that creating an electronic voting system, which is tamper-proof and provides complete anonymity, is possible within the blockchain. Using this technology can also potentially increase voter turnout by making it possible to reliably vote through the mobile applications. In 2018, the city of Zug in Switzerland piloted an e-voting program. The participants had their digital IDs created and registered through the Uport app that ran on Ethereum. In a follow-up survey, 42% of the respondents expressed satisfaction that e-voting is slowly becoming an option, and the trial was considered a success. A similar solution also tested in West Virginia, where the voting app enabled overseas residents to participate in the US midterm elections. To prove their eligibility, the voters were required to take a photo of their ID and make a short video of their eyes moving. In this particular case, facial recognition was used to confirm private key ownership. The local government called the trial a success, but not enough data was disclosed to perform an independent evaluation regarding the security and the accuracy of the process. Of course, those two pilot programs were conducted on a really small scale, but they already showcase both the opportunities and the challenges of using DLT in the voting process. The most fundamental issue, ironically, stems from one of the main advantages of using blockchains for voting. While a blockchain is decentralized, the elections, at the end of the day, have to be handled by a centralized entity. This means that public institutions have to be engaged and have to agree to manage the process in a decentralized manner. Defining levels of control and governance in this process could pose a huge technical and legislative hurdle, other problems can stem from the typical blockchain challenge of striking a balance between decentralization, scalability, and privacy, the ever-present scalability trilemma. Apart from voting, managing digital identities on the blockchain also holds the potential of increasing the efficiency of the government services. It can also reinforce people's trust in the authorities thanks to its tamper-proof and transparent nature. In a wider perspective, it can be used in tax systems, providing social security services, or issuing documents. But its impact can also be felt in everyday lives. Imagine that the validation of your identity could take place simultaneously with the action that requires such validation, and you don't need to produce an additional proof of ID. These could range from serious matters, such as buying a house or receiving medical care, to really trivial ones, such as buying a beer. As we see, blockchains can theoretically set the framework for seamless and secure usage of digital identities by human beings. When compared to conventional identity management systems, it is more secure, transparent, and more tamper-proof. It also eliminates the risk of human error. But it is still too early to consider it an ideal solution for mass usage in public services, mainly due to the lack of standardization and interoperability. The good news is that there is a growing number of public authorities, academic entities, and developers working on improvements to this technology, which will certainly result in us finding the solutions to all the challenges mentioned in today's episode. Before you go, please note that this content does neither represent financial, legal, or tax advice, nor is it supposed to be understood or interpreted as solicitation to buy or sell any securities, coins, or tokens. Thank you so much for watching. If you like this video, make sure to hit the like button and don't forget to subscribe to Blockchain Central to never miss a beat. Also, check out our blog, link in the description below. You can also follow me on Instagram at TheBlueMantic to catch up with my other projects. See you in the next one.